It's one step at a time with God, because he stretched forth the heavens like a curtain. He makes the mountains move. This is what God is saying. See, God announces who he is and what he's doing. And he's looking for somebody who would believe that he has all power in heaven and earth. He's looking for somebody to believe and throw in all that they have and trust and reliance upon him and begin to step out beyond all the regions and realms of doubt and step out beyond all the limitations that your own mind and your own thinking would confine you to. You really don't need much help from anyone else. You've already been well trained in self-reliance. Oh, but God the Holy Ghost is going to teach us something different. That's why God the Holy Spirit has poured out his glory into our midst. Father has given us his anointing. Father has given us his glory so that we can learn to absolutely rely upon him and trust in him and not live a limited, confined human existence anymore, where we're constantly overwhelmed by a tired body. Hallelujah. Now I'm telling you, these things are the truth. I mean, come on, people. We practice this all the time. My wife and I got 42,000 miles on us. 42,000, that's right. I said 42,000 miles on us just over the past couple of weeks. We don't know what time zone we are in. And sickness and tiredness would set a pin upon our lives. I mean, I went home and I just went into a coma. I didn't care nothing about food or anything. I was bang. Oh, and then I woke up. Oh, it's time for the meeting. And the Spirit of the Lord laid something on my heart, breathed into me. You know what? And the thing about it is I could easily get here and I could be overwhelmed by the tiredness. I could be overwhelmed by all the things that my body would try to impress upon me. But I have something bigger than what my body would try to impress upon me. I watch people yawning all the time, going for a drink of water, going just satiating all their human need. Satiating the human need, human function, just jamming it in and ramming it down. Making room for some more. My God in heaven, it's time to get spiritual. My God in heaven, it's time to start living by the Spirit. My God in heaven, it's time to start taking on a whole new definition and meaning and value of your life. It is time you stop living the roller coaster Christian life and start taking the exponential approach, man. Where it's always just moving forward. We're not having to, you know, I just praise God when I get to see people come bring the sacrifice of praise and bring in a sacrifice and an offering of God with this big radiant smile. I'd rather see people come in with a radiant smile and a confident boldness because they're shining with the presence of the Holy Ghost than all the money stacked up on, you know, into a mountain, you know, as it were, gathered from every corner of the world. That's not the offering that Father desires, but a broken and contrite heart. One so confident, so and so submitted, so and so thankful, one so blessed by all that he's done. Because that's what a broken, contrite heart is. It's completely surrendered over to his will, totally impressed by him and depressed by everything else. Amen. Hallelujah. Just run away from it. You know, Father is cultivating a fruit, and I can see, you know, I look back in revivals in the past, and I can see where God began to move upon certain men and women's life concerning what it is, the mind of the Spirit, and what the will of the Father is. And more, they went after it. Like, you know, for example, you know, Param and the guys that were around him and Seymour and others, how they begin to just go after this expression of the Holy Ghost, this divine utterances of the Spirit, because that's what the Father was moving upon our lives to do, is crying out to the church, you need to take a hold of that baptismal anointing that I've given, a place where you can be taught of the Holy Ghost and move into a realm of divine instruction, where praying in the Spirit you built up in your most holy faith, that you where you can come into that dimension of relationship with me and be so built up and so matured that now all of these dimensions of heaven's purpose and the divine will of the Father might be expressed even in a more matured fashion with respect to who the person of Jesus is. And I could talk about other revivals and other moves of God, but I'm going to tell you what God is doing right now in the heart of those who hear his voice, those who are moved by his Spirit and moved by his hands. He's got us there looking at these works and greater works and recognizing, wait a minute, this is not what's happening. These are not the things that are taking place within our lives. And we begin to cry out to God in sincerity and with hunger and with thirst, saying, Father, these works, we know that this is your will. Father, these works and greater works. And in that, we begin to cultivate something, a precious fruit of an expression of the Son, Christ Jesus, in our life. An expression of all that Father has. I mean, think about what Father's done. He's not limited any dimension of himself. He's given to us his glory. He's given to us his anointing. He's given to us his very own spirit. He's restored all things unto us in the dimensions of relationship that he's purposed for us to have, to be heirs with him and co-inheritors with him, to be his representatives, to be those who go everywhere, executing his will as he originally purposed Adam to do, which Jesus Christ did to the full. Hallelujah. And now continues to do it. Some people think his work's over. He's right in the big middle of the now. Hallelujah. It's time you get out of the past and get out of the future and get into the now. Everybody's talking about in the sweet by and by. How about in the sweet right now? Hallelujah. People think that God's going to come and open up their mouth and move their hands upward and get them to begin to cry out to God and express a need. No. Father's waiting for your response. I've watched so many people just come up and give a little mealy mouth, blah, 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 and expect that God's going to answer that with his fullness. Give me a break. I don't see people hungry doing that. I don't see people getting all anxious and intense about, you know, getting something fixed in their life and doing that. They holler it. You know what I'm saying? They're yelling at one another. You listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. A yells from hell, shout to the Lord. It's time to lift up your voice and begin to cry out to God for what you really need. Yes. People trying to impart something to people that they themselves don't have. Trying to expect things in their house that they themselves have never functioned in. Trying to expect them things in the life of God's people that they themselves have never been partaker of. It's time for God's people to get real and get honest with God. Say, I'm no longer going to be moved by the cares of this life that would choke the fruit. I'm no longer going to be a yawner in the house of God. I'm going to be one who's got the rivers of God busting out of them. I'm telling you right now, you let one little touch of heaven come upon your soul, and it will absolutely cause you to be overwhelmed with the dream. And beyond. Hallelujah. He stretched the heavens like a curtain. He makes the mountains move. Just think about what he wants to do for you. Huh? While you yawn, look at your watch. I'd no more go for a swig of water while the moving of the Holy Ghost was going down than I would do anything else to distract from his attention. Come on now. And I'm telling you right now, you just follow us. Ain't nobody singing as loud as we are and then preaching the whole time, prophesying the whole time, shouting the whole time. You don't see me going for water right, left, and center. Huh? I don't need any crackers to entertain me. Come on, people. I want you to just get with me here tonight. I want you to get passionate about God. I want you to look into the mirror. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to get so stirred up. I want you to get so stirred up about the things of the Spirit of the Lord. I want you to look with me in Isaiah 44 and verse 3 real quickly. Because there is something that is absolutely essential. Listen, people, I'm telling you, there is a neediness which God demands, and a neediness isn't sitting around all silent unless there's something seriously mentally wrong with that person. Huh? Unless they're mentally handicapped or neurologically, physiologically handicapped. Are you listening to me? When there's a desperate need, there's a desperate cry. Hallelujah. You didn't come out all silent. You came out screaming. Yes. Ah! Wah, wah, wah! Describing your need. Hallelujah. And then, you know what? Don't you pretend, because I know exactly what you do. I don't care who you are. As soon as something gets really important to you, your mouth becomes wide open, and the shout of your voice becomes heard everywhere, expressing that which you have willed and you have purposed. It's time for you to start willing the will of God and being moved by a Holy Ghost need. Hallelujah. Boro Satani. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 44, look there with me, please. Verse 3, Isaiah 44, 3. The Lord says this. He says, For I, the Lord thy God, forgive me, for I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. Jesus cries out if anybody's thirsty. He's still crying out. Somebody just thinks that's some event. People, God isn't talking. God isn't living in the realms of events, just some visitation. An event came for us to have a habitation, to have an ongoing relationship. Come on now. I can tell some of you haven't been standing in the glory. You know what? When you stand in the glory, you know what is going to happen in your life? You're going to be shining with His presence, and there's going to be a hungry heart in your spirit. Hallelujah. Listen, God, there's a place of transfiguration. That's the place of being no longer constantly overwhelmed by the affairs and the thinking and the realms of this world, but rather being transfigured. Don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured by thinking different about yourself. Hallelujah. A place where we come and we see it there revealed, for example, there in the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus there began to pray and began to talk to the Father. And there, as He was entering into that realm of the Spirit and that deeper engagement in the realms of glory, because He knew how to go all the way. Jesus didn't know how to just halfway get there and then not get the thing done. He knew how to have an effective prayer that if someone was blind, they would see. If they were deaf, they would hear. If they were crippled, they would walk. If they were dead, they'd be raised to life again. He knew how to enter all the way into that realm to where a Father showed up and His presence was manifested, His voice was heard, and He was transfigured, and His very clothes began to glow with heaven's eternal light and glory. And I'm telling you right now, that's not just something for Jesus to have. It's something that He's given to all of us. It is something that He demands of us. It's something He's purposed for us to do, but we're not willing to do it. We're so busy. We're so preoccupied. We don't understand how influential the spirit of this world is. And the only thing that is going to eclipse that and shut that down is need. Need, hunger, and thirst. And the only way that need is going to be created and hunger and thirst is going to be created is because somebody begins to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to them out of the realms of the spirit of wisdom and revelation. They begin to see the Word of God, and they begin with an honest and sincere heart, begin to turn to Father and say, "This is what You've demanded, oh God. This is what You've commanded. It's what I demand of myself. You commanded it, and I demanded of myself. I won't live without it." You can't be religious like that. You're either going to be, I have one or two places you could stand, either religious or baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. There's no other place to occupy. You're either religious or you're in the Holy Ghost and fire. I want to teach you the simple Word of God and how you can understand how to give yourself to continually moving and functioning in these things of the Spirit, allowing God free course in your life. Because the more you the stronger that it will get, the more powerful it will get, the more impactful it will get. The more expressive God will take hold of you. The more you allow these holy emotions to stir within your life, the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. The things which the Holy Ghost teaches, the Holy Ghost brings contrast, showing to us that there are various different dimensions of the spiritual. Hallelujah. Haramangaya. Halebarasotoya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I expect that every person in this place is so baptized and so filled with the divine power of God's goodness and glory that any time there needs to be a moving of the Spirit, you have one to stand up and bring. Hallelujah. Abramongasiatevasia. There's got to be somebody in the room that knows how to cast out a devil. There's got to be somebody in the room who knows how to lay hands on the sick. There's got to be somebody in the room that knows how to prophesy. There's got to be somebody in the room that's so filled with the Spirit, so filled with God, so filled with the life of Jesus that they're in season, they're instant in season and out of season. It doesn't matter what's going on. You might be in bed sleeping, snoring in a coma, 3 o'clock in the morning, get woke up, and you right there with the name of Jesus and the divine power and His glory to do whatever it is that needs to be done. Because He who stretches the heavens like a curtain and like a mountain and make the mountains move, He parts the sea for me so that nothing can hinder me. Come on, man. That's what God's saying. That's what the Holy Ghost is saying. The Father's just looking for some people who will trust Him like that. And it's impossible for you to trust Him like that until you allow the Holy Ghost to begin to move in your life and have free course in your life, that you standing there in His presence, you yourself begin to experience the transfiguration. Hallelujah. And in that presence of transfiguration, in that presence of the moving of God in your life, the freedom of the Holy Spirit to overwhelm you with these wonderful things that belong to heaven, of the holy emotions, the joy unspeakable and full of glory, the peace that passes understanding, in that realm, you start thinking different about yourself. You start thinking like that. Hallelujah. The Lord says, I will pour out water upon him that is thirsty. I will pour out floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed and my blessings upon your offspring. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when you begin to think about some verses of scripture, and I believe mostly minister out of John chapter 14 tonight, because I want you to stir you up about this relationship that Father's called us into, a fruit that he's cultivating. Something that can only come to pass because you and I are willing to allow the ministry of Jesus to become effective in our life. The ministry of Jesus at the cross becomes effective in our life when we call upon the name of the Lord and he does his wonderful work of grace whereby he gives us the gift of righteousness and holiness, having with his own blood washed away every stain of sin. To where there, that place in him and that confidence in him and that faith which he brings, we actually purchase for ourselves, as it were, as a free gift, but a purchase, because as both words are used, that word is used by Jesus in his address in Revelation chapter 3 to the churches, where we have white raiment, where we no longer is there any shame. No longer is there any nakedness, but there is confidence and boldness in God, because we know that we're accepted and beloved, and we have access into his presence, so there's nothing that hinders us or holds us back. We have desire for nothing else but him. God, the Holy Ghost, produces that. Isn't it wonderful to begin to enjoy such a blessed, wonderful grace? This resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, where we begin to recognize, wait a minute, I'm raised up together with him, and I'm alive together with him. He's in me and I'm in him. This beautiful place where that causes a transition in our life to where our affections aren't on this earth anymore. Our affections are in heaven. And thus, with our affections in heaven, nothing can choke the fruit that God wants to produce. Little old green, hard fruit. And that's it. That's the full ripe product. That's all you're getting for the harvest this year. If you want anything else, you're going to have to wait till next year and hope for something better. And you go looking on the branch and there's thorns all over it. And you wondered why. Father's cultivating a fruit and he demands it to come to pass. And Jesus Christ, he's there committed to saying, he says, Father, let me dig around it. Oh God, let me labor with you in your husbandry. Father, perchance that this next year, perchance that this next event, perchance that we can bring them to a place to where they'll will what we will. I tell you right now, willing what God wills is very apparent in our life, because it produces within us a desperate hunger and a desperate need that causes us to cry out. I'm going to tell you right now, if there was something chasing you like a mountain lion, you wouldn't be going. You'd be screaming. Ah! You'd be yelling, help! It'd be louder than that too, because you'd have all this inspiration. A particular kind of inspiration that comes through self-preservation. God wants to inspire you. Hallelujah. But my goodness, when you're so stuffed up with the things that the enemy would try to do against you, I'm telling you right now, you better understand that you begin to get into this thing that God is doing right here in this place, this move of the Spirit, this fresh moving of the Spirit, and this fresh stirring of the Holy Ghost that's happening in this place. Satan's going to come with fangs bared, and I'm telling you, just do everything you possibly can do to shut it down, shut you down. Because what makes a moving of God, what makes revival, what makes an outpouring of God, isn't just one person or a couple of people. Huh? That's intercession. What makes a moving of God is a participation of everyone. The enemy's just looking for weak links. He's just looking for people that he can influence and infect. Not affect or effect, infect. Somebody said, is it affect or effect? I said, it's infect. Hallelujah. Say, God, I'm Ashayatera. Hallelujah. I'm not being infected. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Before I minister on the things I want to minister on, I want to just look at this, where the Lord Jesus says in Luke chapter 24 and verse 48, verse 49, he says, "Behold, I send the promise of my Father." The promise of the Father is very important for us to grab a hold of. Jesus said, and I believe it's in Luke chapter 11, he said, "If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Ghost to them who ask?" Hallelujah. You know, there was an event that took place on the day of Pentecost that's absolutely essential. It's the heavenly ministry of Jesus. It's the means by how it's the precedence of how the church is supposed to function. The church isn't supposed to function in singing some songs and everybody just trying to gather around and then having some preaching and then taking up an offering or whatever. The church is supposed to function and flow in the Holy Ghost and out of the Holy Ghost, out of that realm of flowing in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Songs come forth. And it's okay if we start singing in this place in God when the service first come into the meeting. Because there are some people there, because I'm filled with God. I stay filled. Hallelujah. And if it ain't evident, I don't know what to tell you. And I tell you right now, you say whatever you want to say, I just want you to have as much evidence as I got in my life. And then we're gonna have some glory coming down. Hallelujah. We're gonna have some things moving around. We're gonna have some Toki Ramasaya, Harababayeshama, some expressions of divine power and glory that's unstoppable, because the church is supposed to be many members moving and functioning, not in some individual person realm and decision making, but all moving into the mind of the Spirit under the force of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. The one thing I can't stand is a religious meeting. One thing I can't, man, I'm telling you right now, if I'm sitting in a meeting and the Holy Ghost isn't in charge, I'm going to do something. I'm telling you, I'm going to start praying in the Holy Ghost or something. Oh, I'm going to make a distraction. Distract people from that religious boring thing. Let God come in. Let the Holy Spirit come in. Let God begin to move. Let God begin to speak. It's time for God to be allowed to speak to you. It's time for God to be allowed to control your life. Hallelujah. Yeah. You know, when you begin to consider verses of Scripture, now I want you to hang with me, because I'm gonna hit you from some different angles. When you begin to understand verses of Scripture like Ezekiel 36 and verse 26, when we read, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you." When you begin to understand that this is the promise of the Father, and that cannot fully be fulfilled just with the new birth. That has to be fulfilled not only with the events of Jesus' earthly ministry, but it also has to be fulfilled with his heavenly ministry of him putting his spirit on the inside of us. I'm going to show you that. You ready? Go look at John chapter 14, verse 17. Turn to John chapter 14, verse 17. Let's go over there. I'm telling you, this yoke of affliction, this demonic oppression, this demon doctrine, these doctrines of men that want to somehow just have a preference not to receiving the heavenly ministry of Jesus, its effect and influence needs to be broken. Jesus looks at his disciples. People want to say all they want to say about how much the disciples were saved and how much they were born again. I'm telling you right now, I know that Jesus made them clean through the word which he spoke unto them. But I'm telling you right now, I wouldn't want to have to try to defend these concepts that many people try to put forward just to salve everybody's, everybody's feelings about whether or not how right they are with God, having not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because reality of it is, Father never expected there to be any kind of separation between Jesus' heavenly ministry, earthly ministry, and heavenly ministry. It's just supposed to be one continuous thing. Amen. When the disciples went down and to Samaria, they didn't go down there and start teaching them the 10 steps to understanding, you know, what it means to be sanctified. They went down there with purpose. You could see what they did. They went down there so they would be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Hallelujah. And they were just as focused when they went down to Samaria in Acts chapter 8 as Paul was focused in Acts chapter 19 when he looked at those believers at Ephesus and said, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" And it's about time God's people get that focus and quit playing games with God as though it was just an event. God's talking about a habitation. He's talking about something we've been privileged with, the riches of God, the riches of the Spirit. We've been privileged to be given this divine unction, and we just want to say, you know, just put it on the shelf till we, you know, suddenly feel some overwhelming, you know, lightning, thunderous move of God at the end of the meeting, and we give God the Holy Ghost 10 minutes a year, or whatever it is that people give Him, 10 minutes even a day, or 10 minutes a week, whatever it is. When God has given us these riches to be built up in the most holy faith, His divine utterances, where we can be taught of God, where we can come under divine control and influence and be built up by the Spirit and come into the fullness of the maturity, the measure of the ministry of Jesus, to begin to function in a greater faith, more faith than there did. Listen, people are just all happy with himself, patting, breaking their arm, patting themselves on the back because somebody got healed of a headache. My goodness, dear people, come on now. And then they got all this, you know, various different doctrines, how it's not God's will to heal everybody just because they don't have enough faith to get the job done. Faith is going to get built up because you're willing to be applied to it, because you're willing to grow in it, because you're willing to allow the Holy Ghost free course in your life to show you how to do it, to show you access and interest in, entrance into a deeper realm, so an entrance shall be ministered to you into the abundance of all that God has. You just give yourself over to this realm of the Holy Ghost, being willing, obedient to participate with what the Holy Ghost is showing and teaching. Amen. Yeah. And I tell you right now, if I was in your place, I'd be drunk in the Holy Ghost already right now. I'd be so excited about what God is doing. Listen, He's given you more than Moses. He's given you more than Enoch. He's given you more than Elijah tonight. He's given you more than Daniel. Oh, somebody said, oh, I wish I liked Daniel. God's given you so much more. I tell you right now, if Daniel was in your seat, he wouldn't be just praying three times a day. He'd be right there running a race with Paul, saying, I speak in the heavenly divine utterance more than you all. Hallelujah. It's about time God's Pentecostal folks, full gospel people, start having a flow, a continuous flow of divine utterance. They come in, they go out with divine utterance. They go to sleep, they wake up with divine utterance. My bed shakes in the night with the presence of the Lord. Ask my wife. She sleeps with me. My bed shakes with the divine presence of the living God. I'm not going to be without Him. I'm desperate for more. I've got to have all that God designed. I want heaven more than earth. I want Jesus more than me. I want His life. God said to Paul, said to Timothy, lay hold on eternal life. My goodness. I'm laying hold on that which God has provided for me in Christ Jesus. I encourage you to do the same thing. Don't let these things slip. Don't think this is some kind of, you know, expression. This is the divine grace of God. This is the promise of the Father. This is everything that He's ever purposed to have. It's the crescendo, the fulfillment, the high point, the high watermark, all that God could give. Ultimately established and poured out when Jesus has finished it all and sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Hallelujah. And then we want to make a religious expression, a little whatever out of it. Give me a break. Stop it right now. Get with the flow. Get with the flow that doesn't stop. Don't give God the Holy Ghost 10 minutes. I'm going to tell you right now, as far as I am concerned, the Bible evidence and proof is you give God the Holy Ghost as much influence in your life as you give to Him to allow the divine utterance to flow out of you. I'm going to say it again. As far as I'm concerned, and the biblical expressions of God are, you give as much place to the Holy Ghost to lead you, guide you, fill you, and teach you, instruct you, as you give place to the Holy Ghost to flow through you with the divine utterance. And that's the evidences of Scripture. God, the Holy Spirit, wants to inspire you. He wants to begin by your own the act of your own will, by the act of your own hunger and thirsting, by the act of your own need, begin to so take over your life. I mean, praying without ceasing and rejoicing forevermore is just the life of the believer. And everything Satan is doing and everything this world is set to do is to try to stop that, hinder that, keep you from that, because you're so filled with worldly Twinkies. You don't have time for heavenly meat or manna either. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stop consuming the stuff of this world. Stop being conformed to this world. Stop being influenced by the things that belong to a place that is foreign to God. Get over in here and let the Holy Spirit begin to build you up and teach you and strengthen you. Because Father has purposed you to go everywhere, living out the glory of His name and the glory of His fame. Father is going to resource you with as much as you're willing to believe He will do. As much as you're willing to have confidence and boldness and certainty in Him and trust in Him and reliance upon Him, that is the proportion by which He will begin to move in your life. Hallelujah. And the challenges are going to come right down to whether or not you're going to let bodily functions overwhelm you where that you can't begin to move in the things of the Spirit. Like being tired and all the rest of the stuff that goes on with it. People constantly making decisions. Well, I'm just going to stay home tonight because I don't feel good. Well, you know what? You're giving strength and power to the wrong thing. You're developing yourself and maturing yourself and not feeling good. You're developing yourself and maturing yourself in self-reliance and moving and operating and functioning under the opinion and the decisions which you make rather than giving yourself over to a realm which God demands and which God dictates. Huh? Listen to this verse of Scripture. The Lord Jesus says, I will pray the Father and He will send you another comforter. This is right on the same level. This is Jesus' intercession, but it's all right on the same level of your Father in heaven knows how to give, will give the Holy Ghost to them who ask Him. He says, and He will abide with you forever. Hallelujah. Even the Spirit of truth, that's the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. When the Holy Ghost is around, no lie can get in. Praise God. No distraction can get in. When the Holy Ghost is given place to you, you're not going to be feeling bad anymore because the truth of God's word is that you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places and you're well provided for. He's providing for you, you know, according to His riches and glory. I mean, the truth. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Now look at this. He says, the Spirit of truth in the world cannot receive because it sees Him not. It does not see Him, neither knows Him, but you know Him. He's dwelling with you right now. But something's going to happen. Something's going to happen. Because all that God promised and what Father promised by Ezekiel in Ezekiel 36, what God promised by Jeremiah in Jeremiah 31, 33, what God promised by His prophets, Isaiah 44, 3 and Isaiah 34, what God promised and declared should be in the new covenant is going to fully come to you on that day. There's something going to happen. The Holy Ghost was with them, but He was not in them. He's going to be in them. That was the day to come. Hallelujah. Marasana Ekeya Shikona night. I'm fine with somebody saying, well, they already received a new heart and a new spirit because the power of the Holy Ghost had come upon them through the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ and they were born of the Spirit. You know, you're going to be hard pressed to prove that, but I'm going to go ahead and go with that. I'm happy with that. Whatever. You know, I'm not going to limit God in any way because He did say, you're clean through the word which I've spoken unto you, all of you but one. And I mean, that would be basically the whole basis. You know, Jesus did say another one strong point of it and basis for it is that Jesus said in John chapter 4 to the woman, He said, if you had recognized who I am and the gift of God, you would ask for Me and I would give to you living water. And so Jesus, I know, was declaring something to her that He had the ability to supply to her right then. Hallelujah. And it would be a wellspring on the inside of you. So there are some who would say God was prophetically declaring that, just like He when He said in John chapter 20, and He breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. He was preparing them, speaking in the realms of faith and giving to them a place and position to receive that which He was about to pour out, because we know it had not been poured out, for He had not yet been glorified. Hallelujah. Not just the scripture doesn't say that he was not yet raised from the dead. It said He'd not yet been glorified. This spake He of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for He was not yet resurrected from the dead. That's not what it says. I can tell you, you know, the day that Jesus was crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords and given a name above every name, the day that Jesus was given the place and position before the Father and given the glory that He had with Father before the world was ever began, it happened on the day that the Holy Ghost was poured out. It was coronation day in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The divine utterance is a declaration of all these things that God has done for us in Christ Jesus and beyond, and even more than that. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You know, the biggest problem that I find over and again is that I see people that say they've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, but they haven't had that day. And it concerns me. Because we look at John 14 and 20, and we say, and the Lord Jesus says, in that day you should know that the Father is in me, that I am in you, and that you are in me. And understanding that is the fruit fundamentally that Father is cultivating, that is Christ Jesus being revealed in us. That is a oneness, not an otherness, not just a part of the company, not just a friendship, but a oneness. There are so many people walking around in doubt and unbelief. They don't know where God is. They barely can even comprehend that they, the temple and dwelling place of the Holy Ghost. They're constantly judging and understanding after the realms of the human understanding, judging and understanding themselves after the realms of the flesh. The first person you need to know after the Spirit is you, yourself, and you. Or in my case, me, myself, and I. Hallelujah. I can't speak in the first person really on your behalf. You'll have to do that for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is a boshikananea will do a wonderful thing for you. The Lord said in that day, hallelujah, in the day that the Comforter comes, in the day that the Holy Ghost comes, in the day that the Spirit of truth comes, the one who leads you and guides you, the one that I will send to you from the Father, the promise of the Father, the one that will endue you with power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, we got a wellspring for salvation, and we got a river for power. Well, that's fine. I mean, I can understand that. But I'm going to tell you right now, the Lord, you're going to be hard-pressed to have 2 to 3 witnesses on that. I understand that and I agree with it, but I'm going to tell you right now, I'd hate to have to be defending an experience of salvation, of the experience that comes from the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ, and be absent of his heavenly ministry, of receiving that which God had given through the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, where he would be in us. I want everything that Ezekiel said. I want this new covenant. I want this wellspring. I want that which causes the desert to bloom like a rose in a garden of Eden, and causes the garden of Eden to become like a great forest, Isaiah said. And sit around trying to figure out where you're at in perspective to that which God has given. Just jump in. I can tell when people are just caught up in themselves. I'll start laying hands on people. I can tell when they're caught up in themselves. They're just caught up, and there's this self-consciousness it's reeking with self-consciousness, ripe with self-consciousness. Because I've got all this thing, all this anointing, all this provision to give, and don't go anywhere. I can tell, I can feel, I've been around this long enough, when the anointing is released, when people receive. You've got to be hungry and thirsty for the things of the Spirit to receive that which God the Holy Ghost is supplying. And I'm telling you right now, sitting around contemplating who you are and what you are and how you feel and how everybody else feels about you ain't going to get you anywhere. How did I do? Get rid of that mess. How am I doing? Does he like me now? So insecure. So intimidated. That's the spirit of fear. I want you to get so filled with the love of God, and the love of God will cast out fear. Someone said, how can I become brave? Huh? All brave is moving past the fear. I'm not interested in brave. Huh? I'm interested in being cast out where it isn't a factor anymore. You get filled with the love of God, his love cast out fear. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, it's twins and cousins and family members like doubt and unbelief have to go with it too. Amen. Hallelujah. All his little cousins, all his little one-eyed cousins. Jesus. Takarana sepia kara takanaya kekapaya. Potom. Quit waiting for tomorrow and get into the today. Quit waiting for later on. Start having it right now. Hallelujah. Manje kara jaya paya. Hallelujah. Praise God in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Somebody said, well, you were just so happy this morning. Now you look like you're a little bit aggravated. Man, I'm telling you, I'm on the warpath. I'm just on the warpath of these things that would try to drown out that which God has done for us with such a high cost to himself. Be just willing to have some kind of substitute, be all happy about themselves when the fruit isn't being manifested. Give me a break. Just sit around and congratulate each other on accomplishing little. Little to nothing. Give me a break. The Lord said these works and greater works than these. Hallelujah. Father's waiting for a precious fruit of the earth to be developed. The Lord will come to us as the early and the latter rain. I tell you, God came to this. God came. There has been a couple of times in my life that I've experienced when the Lord came and saw sovereign moves as the early and the latter rain. One of them when I was a little guy. I remember those experiences in God. I remember feeling the awesome presence of God. I mean, I wasn't all, you know, I didn't have any resistance built up at that point in time. I was just, you know, this there, you know. Then one of the great moves of God that took place in the great sovereign refreshing move of God that began to take place in the mid-90s. I'm telling you right now, I didn't sit around and try to speculate, try to investigate. I just dove in head first. Everybody else sitting around going, I wonder what the pastor's doing. I wonder what Mark's doing. Oh, what is he off in now? I'm off in the Holy Ghost, man. I've been hungry. I've been thirsting. While you were sitting there feeding your face, I was down on my face crying out to God, saying, oh, God, send the moving of your spirit. Huh? While you were buffeting your body, I was in prayer. While you were doing elsewhere, I was there in prayer going, oh, God. I was cultivating a move of God in my life. I was cultivating those things that Father was cultivating so that when he came as the early and latter rain, I'd be right there in receptivity. Reception of it. Moving with him in it. Come on, people. I'm talking to you about where you're at right now. As you lift up your voice, you begin to seek God. Hallelujah. I praise God tonight for the things that are going on. I praise God for the moving of the Spirit here in this place tonight. I praise God for everybody who was here tonight is participating with a smile and a joy and a rejoice in your heart. I'm telling you, I love watching Annalyn and Brittany tonight and some other people just caught away. Just Jesus got it all. You show me a person who just give it over, everything over to the Lord, and I'll show you a person who will mature quickly in the Holy Ghost. Show me people just holding back because they just all self-consciousness, they're just tightly hugging themselves. I'm going to show you somebody that's not going to grow very fast. But I'm going to tell you, I don't care who you are, you just stay with the program, because I can remember times when Brittany was standing around going, what is it going to take for me to break through? Why is everybody so happy but me? You just stay right here in this place. You stay right here seeking God. I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to give you more than you bargained for. He's going to give you far more than you ever thought or asked about. I'll tell you right now. God ain't going to leave nobody out. He ain't leaving anybody out. I mean, he paid such a high price for you to get in. All you got to do is surrender to him. All you got to do is stop living for yourself and say, oh, God, from this day forward, I don't live for you. This is God's love language. I don't want to do my own will anymore. I want to be fully used by you. I don't want to just be a little in your kingdom. I want to be great. I want to do everything you commanded me to do, everything that Jesus did. I'm purpose to do it. Somebody said, you can't do that. What are you talking about? Jesus told us to come and follow him. He's given us his ministry. There's not a different kind of ministry than the ministry of Jesus. That's why we received the same anointing. God has anointed us together with him. Hallelujah. Sanctified us by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Papa wants you to learn how to honor the anointing, love the anointing, reverence the anointing. God wants you to quit being so picky and choosy. I don't care where I see the anointing. If I see the anointing in a small child, I'm excited about the anointing. All I'm looking for is the anointing. Somebody said he doesn't like me. No, I like it just fine. I'm just hungry. See, you stop being so full of you. And start when you can be so full of God. It's just pathetic. You know what I'm saying? Why be so wrapped up in your own issues when you can be caught away in his glory? Come on. Why hang on to your pain and your sorrow and your sickness when God would fill you up with all his goodness? All you got to do is walk away from it. All you got to do is sidestep it. All you got to do is quit allowing yourself to be involved in it. Check out. Check out of the world. Check into heaven. Check out of the problems and circumstances and things that belong to this life. And check in to the will of the Father and the life of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Bongoras de Renea. Woo! Woo! Yes! I'm telling you right now, this is the time. This is a great week for you to grab a hold of the things of God. Wake up in the morning in prayer and intercession. Why? Because this is a week that we've basically set aside pretty much to a revival week. Although we're not going to be meeting Monday night and Tuesday night. We'll meet on Wednesday night. We're not going to meet on Thursday night, but Friday night and Saturday night. And Sunday morning, we've got a purpose or something in God, not just another meeting. Amen. You need to rise up and see how much influence you have. And begin to invite people to come. If you have any influence with other ministries, invite them to come. Got influence on Facebook, tell people to get here. If you got a car, go pick somebody up. See how much anointing you have. Do you have enough anointing to get somebody here? Some of you may have to team up because it may take all the faith in your house to get one person. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. I'm going to tell you right now, you might have faith in some dimension, in that dimension, another dimension. But do you have faith in the seeing souls come into the kingdom? Because I'm telling you, that's the faith that God purposed to cultivate. That's what Jesus did more than anything else. Everything that he did in the ministry that he performed, and how that God anointed him with the Holy Ghost and power, went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him, was all about touching people's lives with the love of God so that they would come to understand that the call of God upon their life, the purpose of God for their lives, so that they could be broken free from the influences of a satanic realm. This is why you and I go everywhere doing the same thing. God's given us the same call, same ministry. Hallelujah. Same divine purpose. Hallelujah. And we're going to have to stand guard because there's a lot of things we've been allowing into our life that are not supposed to be in our life. And I think one of the big things is sorrow and depression. Because I'm telling you right now, if it's not putting the light completely out, it's a shade so bad, you're putting a damper on yourself or allowing a damper to come upon you. We don't know whether you turned on or not. Hallelujah. That's why I screamed out, turn it on. Amen. Hallelujah. It wasn't just the overhead. It was the head, too. To growing up into him in all things. You hold Christ Jesus in his proper place, and you will grow up into him in all things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't that beautiful? My. That is an exciting prospect. That's an exciting thing that I know I will step into. You know, you might go to work for some people and they say, you know what, you're never going to be an executive on the executive team, but we're going to get you as high as we possibly can in your pay scale as a worker. You probably never get to be a manager because we don't feel that you're qualified, but we're going to get you as high in the pay scale as we possibly can get you, you know, in the position that we put you into. Father doesn't do that to us. Doesn't matter who we are, where we come from. Doesn't matter what anybody said, our IQ or our mental capacity, our human effort or ability or skill sets or talents are. He said, I empower you with the fullness of everything I got. I give you the unlimited realms of my divine power and glory. And then we acting like we want to go after something in the world and put all of our time into something in the world. Give me a break. Huh? Listen to me. Why don't you go for a PhD in the kingdom of God? Amen. Surapa. Why don't you go for the highest degree of being able to enter into the realms of the Spirit? Hallelujah. Rather than laboring for that which profits nothing, that which will perish by the using, that which will die with you. You can't take what you know and impart it into somebody else's head. It dies with you. When all the time you could have lived for God and you could have impacted your generation and imparted things that will never pass away and established things that will live forever. Oh, God, in Jesus' name, I pray tonight somebody gets stirred up. I pray tonight somebody gets so hungry. I pray tonight somebody gets so passionate that they lay hold They lay hold on eternal life. God doesn't have different kinds of life for you to pick and choose. Green life, pink life, purple life, banana flavored, orange flavored. God's got one kind of life. Life, half Jesus, half you, one-third Jesus, two-thirds you. God's got only one life. It's the life of Jesus. He's looking for some people who will stop trying to live their life and his life too. Ha! Where your whole existence becomes about him. Oh God, reveal yourself in me. Oh God, I understand the fruit that you want to cultivate, that you purpose to reveal your son, your only begotten one, Jesus Christ, in me. And I'm now going to rise up against all those things that would try to stop that, try to lead me into another way. Some sorrowful thing, some depressed thing, some murmuring thing, some complaining thing, some backbiting thing, some strife thing, some division thing, some lust thing, some pride of life thing. Some weak and frail thing. Some I ain't nobody thing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody says, well, why does he do that woo thing? Why does he do that scream thing? Because it's either that or take off running. Hallelujah. I don't know. I might be leaping tonight. I might leap over some chairs tonight. Kambon Jerepeataya. Nang Jeli Mingoshti. I saw a preacher one night who was just so bound up with self-consciousness and how he looked and how he talked and, you know, and his bouffant. You could just see everything was just like, I mean, everything matched. It was perfect. I mean, it was ridiculous. And the power of God hit him. It was about the fourth row. He started climbing over top of people, tearing off his tie, his coat. I mean, his hair was going everywhere. I'm literally crawling over top of people, stepping on them to get out of the middle of a fourth row, to get out into the aisleway so he could take off rolling on the ground. Hallelujah. Somebody said, that's a bunch of emotionalism. You need some. You need some. You need some of that emotionalism. Ah, I pray you get a double. I pray you get an unlimited dose. Fact of it is. Hallelujah. I tell you, start getting emotional about God, you won't be emotional about all the other stuff. You start getting filled up with the pleasures of heaven, and the pleasures of the demonic will look like hell to you, smell like death to you. That'll be an offense to your soul. The only reason people can even be caught away into that stuff and snared into that stuff is because they're so empty of God. Ah, you come into his glory, you come into his presence, there's fullness of joy. There's pleasures at his right hand that nothing can match in this world. Nothing can match it. Nothing. Nothing. The exhilaration of it, the glory, the ecstasy of it. Nothing can match it. Nothing. Nothing. Father wants to teach us how to begin to move and how to begin to function in the entrances into his glory. Entrances into the kingdom of the dear son. The entrances in. Huh? You begin to understand an entrance in and you can begin to cooperate with joy. You understand an entrance in and the divine utterances can come. You begin to understand different entrances in. You can flow in prophecy. You have different entrances in the word of knowledge, the interpretation of tongues. Oh, there's more. There's an entrance in to the place of his divine glory and access by the Spirit into all the fullness of God, a place of unlimited love, unlimited peace, unlimited boldness and confidence. Father wants you to begin to explore all the height and all the depth and all the length and quit being so stuck with whatever it is you think. start getting hungry, start getting needy. Well, hunger and need is has to be preceded, has to, what has to come before hunger and need? You got to believe it. Something's got to happen. You got to be able to read the Word of God and realize that this is reality, that this is for you. You can have these things. And then that will be, when you begin to understand, wait, this is God, what God has commanded, I'm going to demand of myself. I'm going to have it now. I'm not going to wait till the clock strikes midnight. I'm not going to wait till New Year's Eve. I'm going to have it now. I'm not going to wait till the sweet by and by. It's now. Right now. Right now. Jesus didn't say to the woman of the well, after you come in and you accept me and you stay in the seminar and then you go to the conference and you continue on several years, then a wellspring will come. He didn't talk anything about the future. He talked about the now. It's yours right now. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. My now. He and me and I am him. Hallelujah. I believe that there is a glory realm of God that Father wants to begin to take place in our life that we have to give place to. He's not going to force anything on you. Satan will force things on you. God's not going to force things on you. You got a hunger for these things and thirst for these things. And there is a realm of divine power and glory that Father wants to freely have moving through our life. That doesn't matter where we're at. It doesn't matter where we're at on the street corner, in the shopping center, walking down the sidewalk. It doesn't matter where we're at. The power of God can move upon us, and the word of the Lord can come forth from us, and the power of the Holy Ghost will cause conviction to fall upon those who hear. Change takes place in people's lives. Just standing there and looking at your face, hearing the praises. I know what the enemy would try to do with these upcoming meetings and try to afflict people with sickness and sorrow and have everybody, every problem and every issue could possibly ever crop up all come at once. You know what I do? I ignore it all. I have already set a priority that nothing can trump it. I have a priority and nothing can get in the way. I don't care who died. I don't care who feels bad or who did what. I got a priority. Nothing's going to trump it. Nothing's going to knock it off. Nothing's going to move it out of the way. My priority is to flow in the Holy Ghost, manifesting the life of Jesus Christ, doing the will of the Father. Hallelujah. Have joy unspeakable, full of glory all the time. Have peace that passes understanding. Have a word in due season all the time. Hallelujah. Have authority to cast out devils all the time. Have authority all the time to lay hands upon the sick and they will recover. Hallelujah. This has got to be in the house. When you accept it now, it develops and it grows and matures in your life. When you don't back down, and where there are things come around that will try to make you believe something different, another report, another gospel, yeah, there will be. To try to get you to compromise and lower the bar, yeah. Try to change God's definition of what he said, yes. But you're not moved. You don't bend, you don't bow, you don't change. Hallelujah. What God says you become fully established in, rooted and grounded and settled in love. What is that? First and foremost, it's love relationship with Father. Hallelujah. It's a love relationship with Father. Hallelujah. And a love relationship with Father is going to be a loving relationship with the Holy Ghost. I was just laying on my bed last night, just talking to the Holy Ghost, going, Holy Ghost, I can't believe how I've mistreated you, and yet you've loved me. I can't believe how I've ignored you, and yet you continue to move upon me. Oh, God, I'll never treat you again in the future like I've treated you in the past. I'm going to give full place to you. I'm going to walk around in that wonderful sacred realm that you have provided for me. I'm going to listen better. I'm going to be a better student. Oh, God, you're the best teacher. I'm going to acknowledge you like I've never acknowledged you before. I'm going to give place to you like I've never given place to you before. And all the time and through the entire process, he's been loving on us, and he loves us, and he never let up, and he never left. He's amazing God. He's so full of love. It's unimaginable. He's so full of mercy. It's unimaginable. He's there forgiving even when many offenses, even in the midst of many offenses, the obedience of one abounds to where that all the offenses are disqualified. Doesn't change God's position, God's call upon our life. All we've got to do is be willing to allow God to effect change, to allow God to bring to pass growth, to bring to pass by His will and His mind. I'm going to tell you right now, with all of it, I have been devoted to that change. I've been devoted to His will. I've been devoted to His way. I've been devoted to His program. With all of my problems, with all of my weaknesses, with all of my failings, with all of my listening to my own instruction and listening to the instruction of people around me that I thought knew well. I'm going to tell you right now, God has never one time changed one iota of His opinion, because I've always been dedicated to having it all His way. That's all you got to be willing to do. All I got to be willing to do is to talk this love language to the Lord and just let Him know how that you want all His word to be fulfilled in you. I promise you, you just stay here. You don't weary in well-doing. You don't faint. I'm going to tell you right now, you just stay right here in this place. You get yourself so positioned in God the Holy Ghost that you're able to cut every doubt's head off on the instant it expresses its doubt or unbelief or whatever else. Every lying, as my mama would say, every lying symptom. She wasn't the first to say it. Every lying thing. Every testimony against divine health and goodness and joy. Whatever it looks like, you say it is and it does not have any place in my life. Rather than yielding your members to it and allowing it to influence the way that you feel and the way that you think and the way that you act and the way that you behave. It's time God's people begin to allow the high praises of God to be in their mouth and a sharp two-edged sword in their hand. It's about time for God's people to allow the life of Jesus Christ to be the only reason that they live. My. Hallelujah. The life of Jesus. Hallelujah. It's the only reason that I live. You know, I love going out to the ranch, what God's doing and developing there for the Mission Training Center. I love that. But I live only for the purpose I live only for the life of Jesus Christ to be manifest in me. I have only one place of fulfillment, only one place of contentment, only one place that I'm captivated by, one thing that is beautiful to me, and that's the manifestation of His power and His glory, touching the lives of people and changing them from the church people to the lost people. I pray that you get so filled up with the same heavenly vision, that you begin to have boldness and authority, knowing that you can take people and snatch them out of the grip of Satan and take them out of the hands of darkness and bring them into the kingdom of God, to deliver them from Satan, deliver them over to God. Hallelujah. From darkness to light. Power and the authority of the believer. The power and the authority of sonship. The power and the authority of those who are endued with power from on high, and in that place are co-inheritors with Jesus. In that place, the heirs of God. The promise of the Father is that which made us, that which conveyed to us the inheritance that was brought to us as heirs. That's where He qualified us as heirs. And that's, I'm going to read here in John 14 here in just a minute, but this verse of Scripture keeps springing up to me, so I'm going to go have you look at it. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. And I want you to understand that what Paul is saying, you know, some of you may be watching me on the web right now or by the YouTube, and you may say, well, you know, I think he's really missing it there. But I'm telling you right now, I've given myself to proving these things in the Word of God. And I've given myself to having these things established in my life by the Spirit of God. And what I'm telling you is certain. What Ephesians 1:13 is talking about is not, he's not just talking about the event of Jesus' earthly ministry, the salvation that comes through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus. He's talking about His heavenly ministry that took place when He was ascended up on high, exalted the right hand of the Father, and poured out the promise of the Father, the Holy Ghost, when He says, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that you believed, after that you believed, you were sealed with this Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit of promise is the promise of the Father to be endued with power from on high. The ministry, heavenly ministry of Jesus, that He is the accepted, only begotten Son who redeemed all mankind with His own blood and brought us back out of the slavery of darkness and translated, delivered us from the kingdom of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of dear Son. Heirship established, co-inheritorship performed, oneness now declared, ascension glory now established as the expressions of divine utterance issues forth from us. Hallelujah. 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 You know, I just want to stop and say something here before I go to John 14. Those of you that in Geneva's women's ministry a couple of Tuesday nights ago, listen, I had not seen what happened. I wasn't there. And I was just speaking by the Spirit, said that you could diagram the triune man. I didn't know she diagrammed the triune man. I was speaking by the Spirit saying, you can talk about the priest underwear. I did not know she talked about the priest underwear. I'm going to tell you right now, the bigger point of it, I wasn't speaking against what Geneva was ministering. I was speaking by the Spirit, declaring to you things out of the realms of the Spirit that says this. God is interested in the outworking, the results of all that you know. And she had the results. Huh? Hallelujah. Because I didn't know anything about that. She just called me up the next day and said, somebody give you a video of the meeting I did on Tuesday night. Who told you about what happened? No, I'm just telling you. I'm just saying I'm expressing what I am expressing by the knowledge of the Holy Ghost. It's not out of the realm of the thinking mind. It's not out of the realm of trying to have the word of knowledge. It's out of the realm of just living in God. It's out of the realm of just flowing in the things that the Spirit of the living God is supplying. I'm going to tell you right now, He's going to read your mail and does every time in every meeting. Hallelujah. He does. He lays out the list for you, and you can act like you ignore it or not. You can say, who told him? I'm going to tell you right now, it's God speaking to you. Nobody told me. It's just God talking to you through me. That's just the way it goes down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful? I'm happy for it. I'm happy for the Lord. Search me, O God. Try me. Know me. See if there be any way in me that's not right. Lead me in the way everlasting. I want to step over here in the spotlight of God's divine power and glory. I want to stand in His presence where every thought is revealed, where every secret of the heart is manifested. I want to be right in Him. I don't want to be self-justified. I want to be justified by Him. I want to be made righteous by Him. Hallelujah. He reveals a thing to do away with it. He reveals wrong things that it may be done away with. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He leads us in the paths of righteousness for His namesake. His namesake is so important to us. It's about His fame. It's about His honor. Whew. It's about His glory. All you and I got to do is believe. He stretched out the heavens like a curtain. He makes the mountains move. He'll part the sea for me. He'll part the sea for you so that nothing can hinder you. All you got to do is begin to step out and recognize in who He is. He's God. He don't need your help. He's God. He don't need our help. He's God Almighty. He don't need your help. He needs you to be yielded to Him, surrendered to Him, willing to trust Him, willing to go with Him. When He says, come walk with me, come here, I want to lead you. I want to lead you up to a place where the sea is to your back. And an army that's set to destroy you is to your face. I want to lead you to a place where you have to absolutely trust me in the face of every fear imaginable, every threat against your self-preservation. Mm-mm-mm. And watch what I'll do for you. Watch what I'll do for you. Watch, if just believe, only believe. That's all you have to do. Nothing will be impossible for those who just simply believe. Hallelujah. Mangeshe kande bondera. Hallelujah. 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 There's nothing that can hinder you. There's nothing that can stop you when you put your faith and trust in Him. When you give yourself to having in your life those things which He's commanded. When you begin to demand Him of your own life where you will not be willing, where you are not willing to live without them. Too many of God's people are so filled up with the world. They find their identity so in the world. They're so satisfied with the stuff that they got in the world. They're so secure with their little house that can easily be burned down and all their other little trinkets that can easily perish with the using that they are willing to be without what God demands. I'm going to tell you right now, Father wants to turn that around for you tonight. Whether you're here or watching on the web, God wants to turn that around for you tonight. To where all that stuff becomes meaningless. It has no value. It doesn't bring you any security. It doesn't bring you any sense of well-being or identity or purpose or fulfillment or satisfaction. put all your hope and all your life and all your desires in him, you can't possibly stand to live without the life of Jesus being manifested in you when he died and sacrificed all that he had so that you and I could have it. He who was rich became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might become rich, and you're not willing to live without those riches. And we're talking about all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm that's already been imparted and already been given. All the wonderful gifts of God, all the wonderful gifts of the Spirit that are yours right now, but they've never been allowed. You've never allowed them to be activated, or you allowed them to be activated, and all the self-consciousness and all the fear and all the intimidation and all the interest of all the human interests rise up against it and try to shut it down. Try to tell you, oh, my goodness, you were really acting silly. Oh, you don't feel bad about yourself in the morning. All that other nonsense, those lies of hell. Trying to prevent heaven in your life. Those things are easily broken down. Huh? Because you don't listen anymore. Because you grab a hold of the power of God. Instead of just doing self-counseling. Which is really bad. Self-counseling, you know, psychoanalysis of yourself. Jesus help us. The counselors come. You don't need to counsel yourself. Talk to the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, how do I talk to the Holy Ghost? Effectively. You just begin to talk to him. You begin to speak to him. And all of a sudden, he begin to show you what actually you would like to hear. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. He begins to rewrite the program of your thinking. Hallelujah. He begins to rewrite the program of your emotions, the program of your attitudes. Ha ha. He begins to rewrite your physical responses. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Best man can do for you is make you brave. God will take the fear away. Hallelujah. Samangay Rashada Mayadea. We were getting ready to go to Africa, and it was just like right, left, and center. Satan was attacking my wife's body. You know, he's a cheat and sneak. He ain't gonna come face me and go attack the wife. I'm gonna smash you. You know, just amazing, you know. He's just a cheat, lying cheat. And, you know, and so. Praise God, we get to smash them. Amen. Satan, you nothing. Hallelujah. You've been defeated and destroyed. You're not even on the radar no more. I just want to serve you notice. Hallelujah. You're not even on the blip. You don't blip to the monitor of what matters. You're all your self-importance trying to impose your threats upon the people of the living God. You have nothing in us. It was just one attack after another, one thing after another. My wife said, no, I'm going. I said, baby, look. You're going to have to take a hold of the things of the Spirit now, and we're going to have to rise up against this thing. And she just laid a hold of it. She said, no, I'll get on the airplane. She says, I'm on the airplane to be healed. She just makes a divine appointment. She says, look, I don't care what the threats are. I don't care what it looks like. I'm getting on that airplane. So thus, when I get on that airplane, I'll be healed. So just mark it down. Huh? And then, you know, we went through all the things that we went through. She's come back, and it's like everything turned around. Huh? Everything turned around. The sleep, the physical health, the strength, everything. It's beautiful, isn't it? It's turned around. Why? Because she wasn't willing to, first of all, I can't even talk her in and go get just, I try to say, well, baby, there's nothing wrong. We go to the doctor and just get a health checkup, just see where you are. She's like, there ain't no way I'm going to do it. I'm not going there. You're telling me to go down into the valley of the shadow of death. You're telling me to go down there and listen to the report of hell, to listen to the lies that men would say. I'm not going. I said, no, it doesn't have to be that. She said, I don't want to hear it no more. I tell you, she is very submissive and obedient. As soon as I start saying something contrary to the things of the Spirit, I'm going to tell you right now, she gets feisty. She gets feisty. She reads me the riot act. I tell her, you're right out. She ain't following me where God's not leading. Hallelujah. And I praise God for that. She ain't listening to me. She ain't coming under my authority when it doesn't sound like the word of faith. And that's beautiful, isn't it? Hallelujah. What a woman of God. Praise the name of Jesus. Ha, ha, ha. Hallelujah. Tangalema Jeremiah Saya. I'm telling you, she started breaking down in all kinds of spots. We couldn't even imagine what it was. What is this going on? With just one thing after another. And just like, you foul spirit of hell. You cannot impose upon us these things. And we don't start thinking bad about ourselves, saying, oh, I must have done something terribly wrong. Oh, no, what's wrong with me? God doesn't love me anymore. No, our response is nothing shall take our uprightness from us. Before we know our Redeemer lives and he stands upon the earth in these last days. In fact, he stands on the inside of me right now. Come on. There needs to be enough confidence, enough boldness, enough assurance, enough certainty that the enemy has no longer any doorway or access to our thinking and to the realms of our faith and the realms of our confidence. Let nothing take your confidence from you. It has a great payday coming. It has a great recompense of reward. Hallelujah. You can say all day long how I'm not right, and you're not going to disturb my confidence one little bit. You can say all kinds of things about how I'm not flowing in the Holy Ghost, and you're not taking my boldness away. You can't even be. I'm hidden away in him. And I say these things because I want you to have the same confidence in him. This is a personal relationship. It's absolutely essential to be able to function in a confidence and a boldness that God has purposed for us to have if this fruit is going to be made manifest in our life. And I want to just, now that I've given my introductory remarks, now that I have given the announcements, Shapaha, and describe to you what I'm going to talk about. Some people don't know where to start in ministry. I don't know where to stop. Hallelujah. I tell you, I got a river supply. I got a Holy Ghost who takes hold of me, gives me the ability to speak on his behalf, act on his behalf. I don't have to have confidence in myself. I don't have to trust in myself. I trust in him. Even when I'm so tired, I can't even have, don't have time to study. He makes up for all this. He just takes care of me, just says, go over there and sleep. Don't worry about it. I'll give you those things which you're supposed to say when you stand up. Hallelujah. God is just so good to us. He doesn't make us earn nothing. Woo! He gives it all as a free gift. Freely he supplies it to us. It's those who receive it freely, don't have to earn nothing with God, have confidence and boldness because what he's done, not anything to do with what we've done, to get to moving these things. It's about time God's people move into a love relationship with him, begin to understand who he is, how loving he is, how caring he is. Mama, how mindful he is. That he's numbered the hair upon your head. Hallelujah. I mean, the old timers used to just simply say, all that I need to do to feel good is just to think about being what he's done for me. It makes me feel good just to know that I've been redeemed. Hallelujah. That's all they need to feel good. They don't need all these other things that are measured by what, you know, you might have in a natural world and what people hold valuable, like money in the bank and a house paid for. And those things have nothing of real interest or meaning. Huh? Only thing a house paid for is good for is that you could sow it in the offering, not give a bill with it. Amen. That's about all it's good for. You can give it into the kingdom of God and there won't be a mortgage attached to it. That's about all it's good for. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Ha po say ataya. Ha. If you've got security in it, there's something wrong with your heart. If you're holding on to it, it makes you feel comfortable and cozy. There's something wrong with your relationship. I just tell you that right now. God says that's what the nations seek after. That's what men seek after. Don't you seek after it. You go after the kingdom. You let me give stuff to you. Anything that God's given to you, you know how you know God gave it to you and you received it from heaven? You know how? You were able to give it away as quickly as you got it. That's how you know. Oh, God gave me this. Okay, we'll just give it back to him then. Well, if I give it back to him, I will be without. Oh, you got that for yourself then. Because you know you gave it back to him, he'll give it to you back, he'll give it back to you as quick as you gave it away, but he'll give it to you more. Yeah. It'll be better, bigger and better. That's just the way God is. We hold on, we clutch those things which we have gained for ourselves. And we say it's that which God gave to us, but it's proven that God didn't give it to us because we won't give it back to him. And it's mine. No. Oh, we want everything that you have. We want you tonight, we just want you to respond to God and be, Lord, everything that I have is yours. I give it to you. I surrender it over to you right now. It's yours. I lay no more claim to it. See, that's the key to, well, one of the keys to revival. One of the keys to the great moving of God is that they all laid everything that they had, all the substance they had, they laid at the apostles' feet, and no one claimed that they possessed anything. It was all belonging to the kingdom. They took that which they had, and they submitted it to God and said, this is all about the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, Father had been putting some big things on the inside of my spirit to believe for big things that only he can give, that I could never earn. See, Father wants me to go into a realm that I could never earn it. I could never think about it. I could never craft it. I could never develop it. I could never invent it. It's something that he gives, just like he stretched out the heavens like a curtain, just like he moves the mountains, stuff that he gives. Hallelujah. He supplies to those who are willing to be good stewards of it, those who are willing to have it for only his namesake, for his honor, for his glory, for his purposes. Hallelujah. 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 My wife is getting up there in years with me, and you know, she says, well, you know, we still don't have a house, but you know what? We have something better than a house. We have a home, a place established for us in heaven, a more certain dwelling. Huh? And women, I know how women are. They all, you know, they all clinging to the earthly realm. Huh? That's why they need somebody to follow who's going to heaven. Amen. Hallelujah. You just put all your trust in God. He's going to take good care of you. Ladies, he take good care of you. Cluck, cluck, cluck. He take good care of you. Hallelujah. That's an inside joke for those who know about it. Tang bong jekena. The cluck, cluck, cluck that was. Beresina. Hastakina meyesh. Hastakina meyesh. Hasta pede nemana. Baros de kirinia. Jesus sets this thing up by going in verse 11 in chapter 14. This is a great revelatory passage of scripture. What Jesus reveals in John 14, 15, and 16, one of the longest sermons Jesus preached concerning how you and I will function in all his divine power and authority as the sons of God. Equating his ministry to our ministry and our ministry to his ministry. Equating oneness on a level and a scale that had never been revealed before. You want to begin to memorize some verses of scripture and make some study of some verses of scripture that is all about you living it, you saying to the Lord, I want to know what you purpose for my life, and I want to place a demand upon myself to have those things which you've commanded, which you've ordained, which you've purposed. Somebody says, what's the will of God for, what's God's will for my life? And I tell people all the time, for God's will for your life is that his son be revealed in you, that Jesus Christ be revealed in you, that you go everywhere and do what he did. So, you know, in that context, pick a number, win the prize. You know, door A, B, or C, they all work the same. Because no matter what you walk into, or no matter what door you walk into, no matter what you pick or what you choose to do, it's all about the advancement of the kingdom of God. Whatever door you walk into, wherever place you go, it's going to have the same results. Christ Jesus is going to be revealed and manifested fully in your life. So he sets a stage like this. He says, believe me that I'm in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Think about this. He's talking about the display of the works that are in his life as the proof of oneness with God Almighty, God the Father. I want you to understand something. I mean, the Lord so struck me with a revelation just the other day. And the revelation is like this. It's a revelation that is fully, all revelation is fully established and provable in the Word. You get a revelation and you can go back to the Word of God and you can see it more clearly. God gives me this revelation saying to me, and the first part of it, you know, it would be maybe common to many of you, but that we are sanctified by the Holy Ghost, anointed together with the Lord Jesus Christ, endued with power to go and show forth the glory of the Father. To show forth the glory of the Father. Jesus has taken everything that belongs to the Father and he's delivered it to us by way of the Holy Ghost. By way of the Holy Ghost that comes on the day of Pentecost when we are endued with power from on high, having received the heavenly ministry of Jesus Christ, that heavenly ministry in which he baptizes us, fills us, immerses us, surrounds us. Now I want you to think about this. When you are in trouble, when you're dealing with issues, when you're going through stuff, what is it like to be able to jump into the baptism? Huh? If you're all hot and sweaty and dirty, what is it like to be able to jump into and swim in some beautiful, crystal clear, pure, you know, transparent, seat at the bottom, you know, unlimited visibility water? Hallelujah. Amen. And when I'm talking about being baptized in the Holy Ghost, I'm talking about being baptized in the Holy Ghost just like they were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Listen, it's like one preacher says, if you jump in the water, you're going to get wet just like me. You can't say you jumped in the water and you're still dry. Huh? If you jump in the water where they in the water, you're going to get wet just like they got wet. You're going to have the same results that they've got. Amen. Otherwise, it's a meaningless context. It's a meaningless word. It's a meaningless declaration. And now it's based on each individual's private interpretation and experience and whatever it is that they've willed and whatever it is that they've thought. So now it has nothing to do with an express purpose of God being made manifest to us. Unless it is exactly what God declared it to be. Then now we know the mind of Christ and the will of God, and what his purpose for us to do when we look at Pentecost and see them baptized in the glory. And then we say, well, that's just, you know, on revival week once a year. That's on pastor's conference once a year and we got to slip in. No. He's talking about a place of habitation, a place where we dwell, a place that then now we allow it to be cultivated in our life because we are now part of his husbandry, part of his building, labors together with the Lord, allowing him to establish in our life the things that he's purposed. And that we're not offline, all interested in what's going on in the world, having things in the world, huh? Having some little trophy. They're not worth $5. And y'all proud of the little trophy. It ain't worth $5, man. You know what I'm saying? You're all excited about a little trophy. Give me a break. Father wants to give you a crown of glory. He wants you to run a different kind of race. He wants you to labor for something more valuable and more precious. Amen. So then, in that context, hear that, huh? And he says, my works is going to prove something, that I'm in the Father and the Father's in me. Then he says, and anybody who believes will do the same works, thus have the same proof. Uh-oh.
Yeah.
What on earth are you saying, Jesus? I mean, brother, what in heaven are you saying? This should be made manifest on the earth. Father is cultivating a fruit. He's got a fruit he wants to cultivate. John 14, 15, 16 establishes the fruit that God is cultivating. Establishes exactly what the husbandman is doing in his husbandry. He's establishing very clearly exactly what Father's purpose to do, that which when Paul understood it. See, Paul got a firsthand information, John 14, 15, and 16, before it was even written, he got a revelation from heaven. And that's why he went immediately out and conferred not with flesh and blood, but got along with God and let Father show him clearly the fullness of the revelation of the new covenant. Thus writing 2/3 of the New Testament to declare to us things that are unspeakable. That many people just are religiously applying themselves to instead of allowing the realms of the Holy Ghost to supply and produce and reveal and manifest, because you had Pentecost for a purpose. The grace of God is not bestowed upon you in vain.
The Pentecost was not bestowed upon you in vain. The promise of the Father was not bestowed upon you in vain. Ha, baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire was not bestowed upon you in vain. The treasure chest of heaven was not imparted to you in vain. But you gave yourself over to these realms of the spiritual, to these realms of divine utterance, to this realm of building yourself up. Hallelujah. On your most holy faith. The building, God's building, God's building. To giving yourself completely over to dwelling and abiding in the vine as a branch, that the fruit that the husbandman is laboring to bring forth in our life might be revealed and made manifest through us. This is only possible by dwelling in him, which is only possible because it's connected. It's only possible by the Holy Ghost, because that is the realm in which it is connected. That is the realm in which it is uttered and supplied. I'm on you now. I'm on you. Are we on you? We on you tonight with the word of the Lord, so that you now begin to break free from the prison of the human realm. I'm telling you right now, if you're going to bust out the shell now in Jesus' name. If you're going to metamorphose like from a caterpillar to a butterfly right now, is the time to do it. Amen. From the human realm to the Christ Jesus realm. From the earthly to the heavenly. Ha. From the sensual to the glory. Hallelujah. Ha. From the profane to the glorious sacred. And it's a decision that you make. And you call it now, and you and believe it now, and you receive it now. Because see, the word of God is going forth, because this is the knowledge of the holy. And God's word is wanting to create within in the inside of you that which Father has ordained. And all you have to do is hear the word, let the word be mixed with faith, and it will profit you. Instead of just thinking that we're giving you a news flash from heaven, FYI, for anybody interested. That you got to go and get mental about it and think and try to work it out in your head, and then somehow it's going to come to pass. No, God's word goes forth and creates. Hallelujah. God says it and it's so. Hallelujah. Perekanaya. Blessed is the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't that amazing, though? Isn't that amazing? Father Jesus is talking about proof. He's talking about how he doesn't speak his own words, how he's not speaking of himself. It's his Father that dwells in him doing the work. And that's verse 10. And then verse 11 emphasizes the work, proof that the Father's in him and he's in the Father. And then he now says it. Now, if he's establishing that when he says these works, anyone who believes these works which I do, he's declaring that it's Father doing it, the work. In it's Father speaking through us. It's Father now that's moved in. We become the habitation. It's Father's purpose. It's Father's glory. Ha! It's Father's realm of honor that's being made manifest, because that's what Christ Jesus, the life of Jesus, is all about, is to reveal the glory and the will and the purpose of the Father and the majesty and the honor of the Father. Come on, think about it. It's just beautiful to me, because it's just a revelation to me, you know. I mean, recently the Holy Ghost said to me, I just want you to start talking about me. I want you to start, I'm here, hello. I want you to start talking about me. I heard the Lord Jesus tell me, I want you to start talking about the Holy Ghost. I sent him to you, he's there. Honor him, he's the most precious one to us. You can say all manner of evil against me or the Father, Jesus said, don't talk about the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He's the one tender. He's the one most tender. He's the one most sacred. He's the one most precious. Huh? He's the one you're not messing with. Father and Jesus are going to take the brunt of the persecution. They'll take the brunt of the blasphemy. They'll take the brunt of the ridicule. But Holy Ghost, don't you touch him. Don't you touch him. Don't you touch him. Hallelujah. He's the gentle one. Huh. I'm about to stay. Not to say that Jesus and the Father isn't, but there's something special, or something sacred, something glorious that you and I need to begin to touch and lay hold on. Hallelujah. He's connected with the realms of the world to come in such a way that we need to begin to understand. The wonderful privilege that we have to every day entering in to the overshadowing. To the overshadowing. To the glory that calls a transfiguration to come, that causes us to be overwhelmed with a different kind of thinking, a different kind of understanding, to be able to see things through the eyes of the Father, hear and understand things through the ears of the Father. with the mind of Christ, to begin to see things as they are, to have our eyes open concerning all that is about us and all that is around us, to no longer be led astray, to no longer be deceived by the things that Satan is doing, who through all of his lies and through all of his deceits and through all of his lusts, this just designed to insult the Father. This is designed to bring disgrace to the name of Jesus. Oh, to have our eyes open. That's what God, the Holy Ghost, is doing. He says, truly, truly, when Jesus pulls this out, you know, the last time Jesus really said that was truly, truly, back in chapter 12, in verse 24, he says, truly, truly, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall on the ground and die, it abides alone, but if it die, it brings forth much fruit. And he's talking about the fruit of his line, the fruit of sonship, the fruit of his own person being reproduced in us, because he's talking about his glory. And then that's why he immediately goes to the next verse in 25 about us losing our life, no longer living for our own purposes, no longer living for our own will. Jesus didn't live for his own life. He didn't live for his own purpose. He didn't live for his own will. He took up a cross, which meant my whole life, my whole existence, my whole meaning is about living for the will of the Father. I'm not planning my life out. I'm not planning a family out. I'm not planning this out. I'm not planning that out. I've purposed to do one thing, the will of the Father. The will of the Father for me is to go offer myself as a sacrifice for all humanity. And he says, take up your cross. And to us, in the same likeness, the Father has a purpose, a divine purpose, a divine will that we discover as we walk it out day by day with him, not living for ourselves, but living for him, to lose our own life, to say, no, I don't live for my own self. I mean, when Elizabeth began to sing the interpretation and by the Spirit of that Rabbas Tekaraneas, we were singing in the Holy Ghost. You know, I could hear resounding to live no longer for our own life, but to live for him alone. Yes. I could hear it again and again. This is the will of the Father. This is where we're going to find the honor. This is where we're going to find the glory. This is where we're going to find the abundance of life. Amen. This is where we're going to find the extraordinary life. Because that's another way to translate that particular word in the Greek language. Not just abundant life, extraordinary life. Yeah. Hallelujah. Exceptional life. Hallelujah. It's the life of God. Think verily, verily, truly, truly, with absolute certainty. This is absolute certain. This cannot be altered. This cannot be altered. I said this cannot be altered. It's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one jot or one tittle to pass away or fail. It's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for any of Jesus, the things which Jesus said, to pass away without being fulfilled. He says, with absolute certainty, I tell you, if anyone believes, and the Lord is looking for people who would believe. If anyone believes, on me, if you would recognize who I am, Jesus is saying, and the gift of God, you would ask of me and I would give it to you. It's just that simple. It's not earning nothing. It has nothing to do with your place in life. It has nothing to do with the culture or the family or the heritage that you have. That's so proven by the example of Jesus. It wasn't like Jesus going to Nicodemus or Jesus going, you know, to Joseph of Arimathea or Jesus going to some special person. He's going to a person completely disqualified by who they are, where they come from, their family heritage, and what they've done with their life. Their life is a shambles. They've lived in shame. They should reap what they've sown. Five husbands now married to one who's now living one who's with one is not married to. Jesus just looks at that person and looks at you and me, no matter where we at. God spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. How much more shall he now freely give us all things by him? To grab a hold of that, to have a boldness, to have a confidence, to have a security, that only comes by allowing the Holy Ghost to minister to you and cultivate within you a love relationship with the Father that causes you to recognize and understand that he's in you and you're in him, a oneness, not a separation, something that he's established, nothing that you earn. Have you begun in the Spirit to now be made perfect or to earn it by your own human effort? Mine, by no means. You begun in the Holy Ghost now to be made perfect by the Holy Ghost. Father's freely. Father gave it as freely as how he's going to develop it and mature it. Establish it. All we've got to do is cooperate. Amen. All we got to do is believe. All we got to do is not faint, not weary in well doing, not let up,
Don't stop dreaming. Don't stop speaking big. Hallelujah. As one man in God said, when you start speaking the things of the Word of God, when you start declaring the Word of God, you open a door into the realms of the heavenly. It's true. The door is open. Now you begin to speak the Word of God, the door is open. Now just walk on in. Haborostika. Haborostika. Haborostikina matuya. Haborostika ramende peredio. I want you to understand, I'm reading chapter 14 of John, the declaration of how these things of oneness will come to pass by the outpouring of the Holy Ghost to get us over into a realm of seeing our lives occupy a oneness with Christ Jesus and a dependency upon Him and a fellowship with Him that comes as the result of dwelling in Him. That's what the anointing is all about. The anointing brings to us special abilities and special insights. And the anointing that we've received of Him, which now gives us special abilities and special insights, is describing to us and declaring to us and revealing to us and drawing us into a place of understanding that we're to dwell in Him. That we're to dwell in Him. That we're to dwell in Him. That we're to recognize that He's in us and we're in Him. That's dwelling in Him. That we're to recognize that He's all for us and we're all for Him. That's dwelling in Him. To recognize that He is continually here with us, will not leave us, supplying to us all that we have need of. That's dwelling in Him. The anointing is describing to us dwelling in Him to where that we know that whatever we ask, we'll receive it. A complete dependency, yes. A trust, a confidence, knowing that we will not have nor live in anything that is absent of that which God has commended. Because we won't allow it. We're not settling out. We're not going to compromise with it. We're not cutting a deal with the devil. We're not compromising with sickness and disease or sin or anything that belongs to the realms of darkness. It's a place of certainty, a place of boldness, a place of identity. It's our direction. It's our meaning and establishment of who we are in Him, these works. But then He takes it even further. And it's not a hyperbole. It's not an exaggeration. An exaggeration is a lie. People want to make it an exaggeration. Jesus is exaggerating to make a point. Nonsense. An exaggeration of the truth is a lie. It's unbelievable that people would actually say such a thing. Accuse God of lying. He said these works, the works that prove that I'm in the Father and the Father's in me, will be in you. And even a greater display, listen to me, and even a greater display that the Father is in you and that you're in Him. And even a greater display that the Father is in you and that you are in Him. And even a greater display. Somebody's going to have to believe that. Somebody's going to have to believe the love that God has for them. Somebody's going to have to quit listening to the lie and the propaganda of Satan. The lies and the propaganda of Satan drew away the mighty angels. What do you think is going to do to you if you give place to it? You're going to have to learn how to rise up in the Word and the authority of the living God and begin to cut stuff off that speaks. You cut something's head off, it can't talk no more. Hallelujah. 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 Don't you see your life any less than this? If you do, you've listened to a myth, a fantasy, something that is not true, something that is taught to you by another spirit other than the Spirit of the Lord. Don't you find your life, don't you settle out for something less. When Jesus says, anyone who believes, if this isn't something that you're allowing and to be developed and cultivated in your life, then there's something wrong with you, what you believe. There's something wrong with your belief. There's something wrong with the realms of
faith in your life. And I'm here tonight to be helpers of your faith, to get it corrected, to get it established, to get it directed in the right place. Hallelujah. Don't fight it. And I know that there's no one in this place fighting these things tonight. Some of you a little bit sad. Don't be sad. There's an offering. His name is Jesus. Don't be sad. Don't look on yourself, the things of yourself. Look on what Jesus is standing there, loaded up with gifts. Come in the door. It's Christmas time, you know. Are you sitting around acting like you didn't get a present? Here he is, got loaded up with gifts, man. You can't even see his face. He's got so many gifts. You're wondering how in the world he's been able to carry them. And they all got your name on them. They weren't gifts for somebody else. They all got your name on them. Hallelujah. And now I'm not going to get very far with this tonight, but I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to stay on it. I'm suddenly beginning to understand why the Lord named the place Abiding Place. I'm suddenly beginning to understand what God purposed and declared long ago. I'm suddenly beginning to get it. Hallelujah. Something you can't get until you're willing to just completely give yourself over to the movings of the Holy Ghost. I thank God I'm not as immature as I was last month. Hallelujah. I thank God I'm not as ignorant concerning the things of God as I was last year. I praise God for growth and maturity. That's what he's purposed for all of us, a continual growth and maturity. Hallelujah. Man, we got some great things to look forward to. Hallelujah. Why be looking behind when there's all these great things that God is developing in your life? He's called and purposed. There's a proof of it right here. It's about you. This is about you. It's a love letter from heaven direction with your name on it. Hallelujah. And the Lord begins to now talk about the relationship that brings this to pass. He talks about the intimacy. He talks about the fellowship. He talks about the oneness. The fellowship in the Holy Ghost, the fellowship in the Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship in the Father. When he begins in verse 13 and says, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, I will do it, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And in the Son, he opens it up bigger. He opens it up bigger, and it becomes more broad when you understand in the Son in relationship to Galatians 1:16. I come to understand that he purposed to reveal his Son in me. The Son becomes much bigger. Hallelujah. Sonship. Somebody said, why didn't we just say, baptize in the name of the Father and in the name of Jesus Christ, the name of the Holy Ghost? Why do we baptize in the name of the Father and the name of the Son and the name of the Holy Ghost? Because the Son opens up a broader view of what Father has brought us into when he brought us together in oneness and unity with his only begotten Son, Christ Jesus. The whole beauty of sonship, the authority of sonship, the place of sonship, the belovedness in sonship. Beloved, now are ye the sons of God. And it does not, even though it doesn't appear right now what you're going to be, we know. Or what it doesn't appear, that wonderful glory doesn't appear on you right now, that resurrected glory doesn't appear on you right now. It's going to happen. Because when you see him, you should be as he is. You should be like him. Amazing. God says that the Son, that the Father, whatever you ask in my name, Father will do it. Relationship. A confidence of relationship. The confidence that John then begins to take and develop even more, saying that we don't allow our heart to condemn us. If our heart doesn't condemn us, then we have confidence towards God. And whatever we ask him, he will do it, because we keep his commandments and do that which is pleasing in his sight. We understand we're obedient to him. We're doing his word. We're living in his word. We purpose to be all that he's decreed us to be, all he's made us to be in Christ Jesus. That's his command. We're walking in that love which he's commanded. I mean, that's the highlight of John. A new commandment I give unto you. This commandment is to love one another even as I've loved you, even as the Father has loved me. The theme of the gospel, the theme of the message and ministry of Jesus. The display and the evidence of who the Father is. Verse 14, if you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. to have this confidence, to have this boldness, to have this certainty developed in our life, that no matter what the circumstances, what the situations, what the events that would be taking place that might try to tell us something different, we don't believe it. We're not moving. We're rooted and grounded and settled in love. We're established in a place that says, no, this is what God says, and I'm standing right here, and I'm not moving. This is the way it is. Hallelujah. I'm going to stand here and rejoice in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it seems to be. I know what God has decreed, and this is the way it's going to turn out. Hallelujah. Everything has to bow its knee. Everything has to submit itself to what Father has proclaimed. And then the Lord, and these are the things which the Lord's commanded. These are the things which the Lord's decreed. Verse 12 is what he's decreed. These works and greater works. He said, if you love me, you'll do what I decreed. People got to focus on the wrong thing. People all focused on not the cause, but the effects. They focused on the results of not being filled up with the decrees of God, not being filled up with the purpose and the identity of God. Of course you're going to have that bad fruit. Of course you're going to have those problems. Of course you're going to have those issues. Of course you're going to be thirsty for things that belong to this world because you're not filled up with all the Father supplied. He said, if you love me, you'll obey me. You'll do what I said. Now, what am I telling you to do? Ask in my name. What I'm telling you to do. These works are greater works. That's what I'm telling you to do. He didn't just list off the Ten Commandments and then say, if you love me, you hear what I'm telling you. Yeah. Kutamanea. He's empowering us to be one with the Father. Woo! Woo! Hallelujah. He's empowered us to be blessed with all spiritual blessing, to have anything we want. Hallelujah. God, because of a relationship that we have. Amando Rateasu. Ha ha. Oh, Raman Jesekiri Bisafai. Thank you, Jesus. Don't I look exhausted? Don't I just seem like I'm just so weary and so worn out that I you know what's going to happen? I'm going to leave this meeting tonight. I'm going to be so full of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to go home. I'm going to die. I will go to the bed. I will go right to the bed. I will actually be asleep before my head hits my pillow. And then I'll be resurrected in the morning. Hallelujah. I'm just energized with God. I'm exhilarated. Hallelujah. We went out and cut 90 logs the other day. And I said, that was exhilarating. And it was. It was some pretty exhilarating work. This is really exhilarating. This is the right kind of work. I tell you, by the time I was done, because when I was younger, I used to have to do a lot of log cutting, trees cutting. And of course, when they're big, old, heavy trees, you better cut them right so they fall in the right place. So it all came back to me. By the time I hit about the 90th log, you know, I was laying them right down where I purposed them to go. Huh? Just giving myself to just 3 hours of cutting logs. And we on it. Hey, man, it doesn't take long to start moving in the things of the Spirit. Just get real about it. Get into the program and sit around and watch me do the work. Huh? Hallelujah. Huh? I don't have to come back and ask you for the 10th time how long you're going to be on break. Is your chainsaw broke? I haven't heard it start up. Come on, get in. Get in, stay in. Get emboldened. Get empowered. Be resourced. It's yours. All of it. Everything Father has is yours. That's what he said. And he's come to prove it to you by the Holy Ghost. You're going to have that day. In that day. In that realm of flowing in the Holy Ghost, you know that Father is in Jesus and that Jesus is in you and you in him. Ha. Hallelujah. Ha, 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 ha. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hengoro mazidia. Hengoro mozarina. Hengoro mozoruniasha. And see, what the Lord says, I want you to understand this. When he says, if you love me, you will do what I said. You will keep my words. And the result of that, of keeping his word, of believing on him, of believing that he's able to do the work, of believing, just like when the blind man saying, "There, I want to be able to see," Jesus is looking at him and saying, do you believe that I'm able to do this? Do you believe that I'm able to create this change and work this miracle for you? All the blind man has got to do is say, yeah, I believe in you. I believe that you're able to do this work. Well, that's the same thing with us. You know, there's not a change going to take place in our life unless we look at the one who can work the miracle and believe that he's the one that he will do the miracle. You won't change. You won't have these things any more than a blind man won't see if he's not willing to put his trust in who Christ Jesus is. So he looks at us right here in this context and he says, here's what's going to be the result of you being willing to believe what I've said. To believe what I've spoken, to believe the gospel, the good news about how much Father loves you and how I give you life. All you got to do is believe on me. Here's what the result is going to be. You're going to get the Holy Ghost. So, come on, man. Let's put the commandments where they are and start reading the Ten Commandments to ourselves here. Okay? And start trying to put things about our own human discipline and our own human effort above the new creation, above the transformation of nature, above the work of the Holy Ghost that empowers us to walk in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might so that we may effectively deal with spiritual wickedness in high places that would deceive us and try to overwhelm us with all that is in the world. We got things all upside down. You need to get them right side up. Start looking at the change. Start believing in the new creation. Start believing in the new nature. Start believing in the new man. Start believing in a complete union and oneness with the living God. I'm telling you right now, get things right. Get filled up with the Holy Ghost and the problems will leave. Sit around focusing on the problems, how you're going to mitigate the problem, how you're going to deal with the damage. Damage control people. Always putting out fires. Can't move forward in anything because you're just constantly busy putting out another fire. By the way, you created. Because I don't care what business it's in, it's result, it's common knowledge, it's result of poor management. And God wants us to allow the Holy Ghost to manage us. Huh? When we manage in ourselves, it's going to be poor management. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We'll give God the control. Are you getting tired? Huh? Not me, man. I'm getting exhilarated. I'm getting refreshed. I'm ready for more now. I'm ready for more of the teachings of the Lord. I'm ready for more of the mind of the Spirit. I'm ready to speak more things that come out of the realm of the Holy Ghost. It's not coming out of the realm of that which I know, but that which God the Holy Ghost teaches, comparing spiritual things to spiritual things. I didn't diagram this before I got here. Did you notice how much I was referring to my notes? Yes. They were already written out 2,000 years ago. Amen. Huh? I don't need any additions. All I got's underlines. At most. I don't need my comments. I want his. I get locked into what I thought last year is going to keep me from understanding the more of it this year. Hallelujah. I'm going to leave it wide open. Let God speak. Just like he spoke before. Oh, God, how'd you do that? Well, maybe I should go memorize the tape so I can reproduce it. Well, it'll be just you because you can't reproduce it. You can't reproduce anything that is similar to the anointing. It can only be produced by God the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And we can be confident that he'll produce it every time. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I will send you, I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter. He's saying, I'm your comforter, but he's going to give you another one. Yeah, I'm doing these works to prove that the Father's in me and that I'm in him, but you're going to do greater works. Huh? I'm your comforter, but I'm going to give you another comforter. I'm going to give you the promise that the Father made long ago. I'm going to give you the promise that the Father made when he said, that you shall crush his head. That the seed, your seed, shall crush his head. I'm going to give you the promise that the Father made when he said, I'll redeem you. I'll give you a new heart and a new spirit. I'm going to give you the promise that the Father made every time a sacrifice was offered that resulted in the glory of God being revealed. I'm going to give you the promise of the Father, the washing of the water, the washing of regeneration, the washing of the water, regeneration, and the regeneration, the recreation, the production of a new and perfect and holy and acceptable being created in Christ Jesus. An acceptable lamb, a lamb without spot or blemish, a lamb that is perfect, a lamb that is holy and acceptable, is born that way. It's born that way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It doesn't make itself without spot or blemish. It is what it is. It cannot change its spot nor its blemish. It's marked with whatever it was born with. We've been born in God, created anew in Christ Jesus. Oh, to find all our identity in Him, all our purposes within the framework of that which God has declared. You say, I'm tired. I need to get up and go to work in the morning. You should quit your job if that's working on you right now. I need my sleep. You should just quit your job. So you can get your sleep and get the Word of God too. Stay late in the meeting. Come on. All the stuff that runs interference. Well, I've been sitting here too long, my bottom's getting sore. Get yourself a cushion. Whatever it takes. Because I'm giving you something from heaven that you need to change your life. I'm giving you something far more important than you're going to get from your paycheck, that you're going to get out of the realms of the world of men. Far more important. Well, I gotta get to be considerate of me. I gotta get out and work 8 hours in the morning. I'm not gonna be considerate of nothing of you other than your soul and the purposes of God and what Father's willed to reveal in you, so that you won't go without what God paid such a high price for you to have because you're so consumed with whatever it is you want to do. It's time you live solely for Him. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you another holy, I'm going to give you another comforter. I'm going to give you another teacher. I'm going to give you another mentor. I'm going to give you another one who's there to cause you to understand and help you to know the ways of the Father, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see Him, neither knows Him. But you know Him. He dwells with you and shall be in you. And I will not leave you comfortless. I will not leave you without a teacher, without a guide, without someone to mentor you and show you how to move into all these things which I've declared and give to you the ability to understand the will of the Father. Yet a little while and the world sees me no more, but you'll see me. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Ha, bangadeya. I have an ability to see things in the realms of heaven that nobody else except those that are born of the Spirit can see. Because I live, you should live also. At that day, at that time, when I send the Comforter, when I give you the Spirit of truth, at that time, at that moment, you shall know that I am in the Father, and that you are in me and I am in you. He brings it all the way back around to verse 10 now. But now includes us in a different dimension. He starts off in verse 10 saying, these works manifest that the Father's in me and that I'm in the Father. It's the work that's proved, it's the works that proves that it's the Father that's speaking in me. and you're going to do these same works and greater works, a greater proof that the Father is in you and that you're in the Father. Because here's what's going to happen. I'm giving you this relationship with me that whatever you desire, I'm going to bring to pass. Whatever you decree, I'm going to make happen. Whatever you ask, I'm going to bring it to pass so that the Father may be glorified in the Son, because you're there representing Christ Jesus. You're there empowered, endued with the authority of the promise of the Father to be those who witness and testify of the person Christ Jesus reproduced in you and me. And brings it all the way around to that day now when the Comforter comes and empowers us and endues us and brings us in to this realm of this divine work of grace. That's proof, that declares, that reveals, that makes known that the Father is in Jesus. And that Jesus is in us, and that we are in Him. And then I'm just got to go ahead, just to underscore, since I got your attention. I just got to underscore it, then with how Jesus then just takes it to another level. In verse 23, having been asked by Judas, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that you manifest yourself to us and not to the world? And Jesus answered and said unto him, if you love me, you will keep my words. You will say, this is true. These works which he did, shall I do also in greater works? That's his word. You'll keep my words, knowing that I told you that whatever you ask a Father would do. You'll keep my words that whosoever believes on me. You'll keep my words when I said, if you lose your life, you'll have my life. You'll keep my words concerning the things that I've declared about who I am and who you're supposed to be. And what does he say then? Once again, I've got to break this down for people, because they start implying things and putting things that aren't even there in this passage that's declaring who we are and what we're made to be in Christ Jesus, in the realms of the new covenant, in the realms of this wonderful declaration and purpose of God and grace of God, in which he was purposed to reveal his Son in us. That's the subject, that's the title here of this whole message. And he says, if you keep my words, if you'll believe these things, if you'll do these things, if you'll hold on to them, if you'll cultivate them, if you won't let them go, if you won't let circumstances and other opinions change what you believe about this, he says that my Father will love you, and we will come unto you, and we will make our abode in you. You talk about Father being in us. You talk about taking it to another level that emphasizes the works, that emphasizes an outworking. When Father is in you, there is an outworking when you're now willing to agree with that. Because I believe that the Father has come, and that the Lord Jesus has come, and the Holy Ghost has come in the people, and they've never been willing to mature in it and really even come to a place of consistently recognizing it so that it can be established on the level of the faith outworking that it's supposed to have. Because you're fully in, consciously in, on what God has miraculously done. Can you hear it? Yes. Can you hear this? Huh? And then he goes and he emphasizes it even more in verse 24. He that loves me not will not do what I said, won't believe what I said. Won't believe that these works shall he do in greater works. Won't believe that I said what I said concerning I'll reproduce my life in you. I won't believe what I said when I declared whatever you ask the Father in my name, I will do it. They won't believe these things of the new creation. Won't believe that I'll make all things new. Won't believe all that I have spoken and all that I have fulfilled, which was also spoken by the prophets. He that doesn't love me will not keep my sayings. And the word which you hear is not mine. It's the Father's word which sent me. It's the Father which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being present with you. Verse 26, he says, he emphasizes, but the Holy Ghost, which is, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost. And I just need to underscore that to you. Just so that everybody says, well, or no one rather might have a question saying, how can you be certain that the Comforter, the one that he's going to send, is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name? He will teach you all things. He will bring all things into your remembrance, whatsoever I've said unto you. What's the Holy Ghost come to reveal? What's the Holy Ghost come to reveal? He's going to reveal Jesus in you and me. He's come to declare to you and me how to abide and how to dwell in him. How to have our existence. How to have the definition and the meaning of our life and the identity of our life in him. That's what the Holy Ghost has come to do. He's come to reveal, make known, bring to pass the new man, the new creation, the new nature. Is he the Holy Ghost who brings forth the new birth? Oh, thank you, Jesus. It's the Holy Ghost that comes to pour the love of the Father on the inside of us, the word that there's an outworking of his glory but within our lives that is displayed on the scale as it were of rivers. Yes. A love that fulfills all the law and the prophets. Yes. A love that works no ill. A love that doesn't have criticism. Criticism comes out of the realm of hate. True. Or suspicion. Or distrust. Or all these other things that people seem to be imprisoned by. They sit in the church. They're not believing what God said. Oh, I just don't seem I can trust you. You're just in hate. You're under demonic power. You're under the reign of a demonic realm. Time to let the Holy Ghost pour into you something that's so beautiful, so glorious, displayed for us at Calvary's cross. Hallelujah. When God, Christ Jesus, bore our sins in his own body on the tree, became the sacrifice for our sins, showed forth the love of God by laying down his life for us, and how now given us by example how we ought to lay down our life for the brethren. Thank you, Jesus. It's going to thunder. It's going to thunder. Believe in me. There's people that are going to so believe this. They're going to start hearing, Father's audible voice is going to come. I'm telling you, I believe it with all of my heart. It's a place of maturing in that which Father says, and you're so rooted and grounded and settled in it. It doesn't matter what's come your way. It doesn't matter what challenges. It doesn't matter what other evidences there are. You're so firmly rooted and grounded, settled in this love, this relationship, this fellowship that describes these works and greater works. These works and greater works. That is a product of what? Oneness. Not otherness. Oneness. Confidence. Boldness. Of who you are in him and who he is in you. To ultimately bring it to God's decree, the sayings of Jesus Christ. Come dwell in me. Find your existence in me. Hallelujah. Understand yourself on the value of a branch in a vine, and that's who you are. Hallelujah. Sukurida mambrudaya. Sukurida mambrudasia tishi. Thank you, Jesus. I want everybody to stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Berimande bechis peron sambre deishi. Father, I thank you for strengthening every person in this place tonight so that they can begin to focus on that which you have focused us to do this week. To not just look at this week and the coming of Pat and Karen Schatzline and the meetings that we're going to have as just being coincidental, but as an event that you've designed, as a thing that you've purposed, that you're looking for us to participate with, to be fully engaged in, to be fully involved in. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that we're not moved any longer by circumstance, but we're moved only by the directions of the Holy Ghost. The things that God's made most evident in our life. Father, I thank you right now in Jesus' name for strengthening every person in this place. Strengthen them in their spirit right now in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you for the wonderful work of the Holy Ghost that strengthens us. Ha ha. Builds us up. Father, I thank you now in Jesus' name for strengthening everybody in their physical body. Those that are tired, be refreshed in Jesus' name. Those that are in the name of Jesus, to be protected and against sickness and disease, against viruses, things that would take you out, things that would try to hinder you, try to stop you. All you got to do is determine that you're unstoppable. I tell you right now, if the enemy thought he could stop you by giving you a flat tire, you'd wake up every time that God had something for you to do, a flat tire. But when it's been proven flat tire, no, you're going. Even if that's rims over there going, crunk, 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 crunk. Does not matter, walking or riding a rim. Either way, you're getting there. As the preacher said, come hell or high water, you're there. Nothing to stop you, nothing getting in your way from doing those things that you committed and consecrated to do. And then you know that God is able then to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you think or ask. Oh, Masataya. Thank you, Jesus. I expect that you should be in greater expectation of the exploits and power of God being made manifest to your life. I expect that every one of you should now begin to give yourself to allowing the Holy Ghost to begin to express through your life in another dimension. Where it's God speaking, not you. Hallelujah. Where it's God at work, not you. Where you just begin to allow God to arise. You allow His waters, His rivers, His glory to be expressed through you. You begin to say, Lord, I'll let your rivers flow through me. Lord, I give place completely over to you now. I'm not going to say anymore that those things which I possess belong to me. I'm going to give them over to you. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I want you to right now just get an offering ready. Get an offering ready. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, Ramama Mandeki di Sheri Mamanda la Pura Viteya. I love my wife. She's had her offering ready for such a long time. I always go check with her, how much did we give? It's just always such a blessing to me. Sometimes women have more, just because of the way they're made, they can have more security in money and finances than men will have. They feel all safe and good so long as there's plenty of money. Forget about that stuff. Get rid of that. Get over yourself. Start trusting God. Quit insulting Him. Huh? That's why I gave my wife the purse, as it were. You spend it. Just do whatever. And I don't even need to know. Sometimes I go ask her, is there any money to spend? So I find out whether or not I can do something based upon what she says is in the checkbook. But you know what she comes to me to do all the time and says? She says this, she says, we don't have it, but can I spend it? She's waiting on me, and I won't answer, eh? And I just wait. You know what I'm waiting on? I'm waiting on the gift of faith. And so it might go 24 hours, 48 hours. Then I come to her, get the faith hit me. I say, go spend it. Write the check. Eh? Because I gave myself over not to calculate out of my brain anymore. Not to think in the realm of human, in the human understanding. But to wait for the Holy Ghost to speak. If I didn't wait for the Holy Ghost to speak, I'd have nothing to preach. And what I preach would be just, you know, it really would amount to nothing. Oh, and I'm just saying this to you because I want you to begin to move by the Spirit. Let God, the Holy Ghost, tell you about how to give, what to give. Father wants to break you into another realm of understanding, another realm of revelation. He wants to take you up to a place of understanding a greater access into the things that have been made available to you, to give you an entrance, to minister an entrance into you, to you, into the everlasting kingdom of the dear Son. Jesus knew how to go into another realm when he took Peter and James and John up with him on that day. He knew what he was going to do. He knew he was going to go. He had already told them, some of you are going to see the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is about ready to be made manifest to you. And that happened. As he began to talk to the Father, and the barriers, as it were, that exist between this realm and that realm were removed. And there you could see Moses and Elijah, the Father standing there. See them with your eyes and hear the audible voice. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. As he's transfigured, as he's glowing in the presence of the Lord. I want you, God's saying, God the Father is talking to us. And I hear him. I hear him talking to me. And I know you're included. You just got to decide whether or not you want to be. Because people decide for themselves where they want to be. Whether they have time for a transfiguration or not. Seeing you so stressed out and busy with all your workload. Things that you got to get done that absolutely amount to nothing. You come on now. It's the same as a squirrel running around collecting nuts, acorns. That's about the height of it, huh? I know it seems so important, but put it on the scale of eternity. Then now measure the importance. Put on the scale of standing in the presence of the Lord after you left this life and gone to the next life, and now measure it on the scale of importance. And suddenly you find it's just nothing. It's nothing. The Spirit of the Lord is just telling us, come find an entrance into standing before me and in my presence of being transfigured. It's something that's made available. It's so made available to us. When we look at Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, it said, do not be conformed to this world, but be transfigured by thinking different. A place where we begin to interact with God and we allow the Holy Spirit free course in these divine utterances, in this divine flow, that there we find ourselves, as the scripture says in 2 Corinthians 3:3, changed from glory to glory, beholding the glory with unveiled faces. That you begin to experience and understand as you pray in the Holy Ghost till the peace comes, as you start taking something to prayer instead of worrying about it and being concerned about it. That's the beginning. And then all of a sudden, you begin to move into another dimension. Can I spend such and such amount of money? I need to send off $1,600 there, $2,300 over there, and just wait. You're going to say out of your own mind, go ahead and spend it, because then you're writing hot checks. Just wait. The Spirit of the Lord says, go ahead and do it. Because I believe the God, the Holy Ghost, is just wanting to see if we're going to let him make the decisions or whether we're going to make the decisions. And I mean, you know, the Lord, you know, perhaps the Lord would like to put $152 million in your bank account. If he knew that you weren't going to spend anything unless he told you to spend it. Then it's going to go wild. We're going on vacation now. I've always wanted to buy a yacht. I'm going to get that and wanted to visit them. Just consuming things in your own lust, right? You be faithful in small things and few things. God make you ruler over many. He will. And I'm saying this in context of you giving. I'm saying this in context because, hey, look. I know that some of you in the natural, you're not making enough money in your job to really pay all your bills. Well, you all the more have reason to believe God for miracle provision. And he's faithful concerning those things that he's promised. God's not a man that he should lie. Just begin to give more with greater abandonment and watch what God will do for you. Give on a level that people persecute you for it. And watch how big it gets. And God, I've watched over and again. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Listen, there's all kinds of things to do in the kingdom. There are people that are needed to be trained and developed in the proper use of the camera and the soundboard and the overhead with a disposition of doing things excellently. Spirit of excellence. That's the Holy Ghost. Things concerning editing the meetings and getting them in various different forms on the YouTube and putting the various different music that God has given to us, making it available on YouTube. That's all ministry of the gospel. People need to put your hand to the plow. You put your hand to the plow and you become faithful in the things that are made available to you, and watch what God will do. You stand faithful, you watch how God will just increase your opportunities, increase the anointing in your life so that you can do more. We want to encourage you to be faithful. If you start doing something, if you sign up to do something, you are not allowed to quit. If we allow you to quit, all we're doing is ministering to you how to just start stuff and stop and be unfaithful. Somebody said you needed to start giving people a one-year contract that they've got to sign before you're training them. No, you've already signed a lifetime contract. So anytime anybody starts to do anything, they come and say, look, you know, come to UK or Elizabeth, say, look, I want to help out and do something. Then they come back in a month later, say, well, I don't have time to do it. You say, too bad. You're in. You trained and you're going to do it and you're going to be happy about it. So, and by the way, here's some more stuff to do right now. Glad you showed up early. Amen.